Ladies and gentlemen, if I could have your attention, please. I think we'll get started, and I'm just going to have some introductory remarks as people still come in, although look at this turnout. I'm not sure quite where they're going to sit, but let's hope that they can find a place. Good afternoon, and welcome to the Aspen Institute's Hurst Lecture Series. I'm Elliot Gerson, and I'm delighted, absolutely delighted, to see all of you here, especially after it's been such a long time since we've been able to be together in person like this. This is the first event of our community programming for the summer, so a special thanks to my colleague Crystal Logan and her team for planning this and so much other wonderful programming here and in the Roaring Fork Valley generally. Next up, next week, is Bill Browder on Tuesday, and on Thursday, for a lighter but still very important conversation, we're featuring the new cartoon editor of The New Yorker, Emma Allen. So it will be a great week, from Russian kleptocrats to some of the best humor in the country. I think that's quite a combination. And of course, a special and heartfelt thanks to Bob and Soledad Hurst for their generous support of this series. And now on to today's program. The title today is The Supreme Court, How Today's Decisions Will Shape Our Future. I might say profoundly. I think when Crystal planned this session some time ago, I don't think she could have anticipated just how profoundly it will be shaping our future. We have two ideal guests for this conversation. Ruth Marcus is one of our nation's, as you know, leading journalists, the deputy editorial page editor of the Washington Post, author of a timely book on Brett Kavanaugh and Supreme Court trends. She brings incredible insight to everything she writes, and as a trained lawyer and an early Supreme Court reporter, I might add particular insights on topics relating to the Supreme Court and generally on the nexus of law and society and the implications of Supreme Court decisions on our politics and our culture. And Neal Katyal, distinguished professor of law at Georgetown Law School, a former acting Solicitor General of the United States, and frankly, one of our country's leading Supreme Court advocates, arguing some of the most important cases, public cases and private cases of our era. I think he has argued 45 cases, Neal, before the Supreme Court, which is actually 44 more cases than I've argued. And I did argue
it's
one.
It's 45 cases more than I've argued, so you're good.
Yes, but my one case, goodness, 35 years ago, I lost 5-4, and that's probably the reason I'm now working at the Aspen Institute and not in a law firm. But you know, thinking about the Aspen Institute, and again, as we still have people coming in, I'll take a moderator's license to just make a couple of remarks. And by the way, we're not strictly held to this hour. We were late getting started, and this is such a big set of topics that I know many of you have questions, and I want to make sure you have an opportunity for that. But there are, a brief historical note and a brief personal note. And with apologies to the few of you who may have been at the Ideas Festival last week, because I mentioned both of these things, and Crystal urged me to do so again today with so many new and different friends in the audience. One of these things I mentioned is little known, and one is little remembered. And they both relate to the case, or one of the cases that obviously we're going to talk about and its implications, which is the Dobbs case and the overruling of Roe against Wade. Roe v. Wade, of course, was a decision written in a 7-2 court by Justice Harry Blackmun. What very few people know is that Harry Blackmun's ashes are spread about 100 meters from here. Not only is that very little known, when Linda Greenhouse, the New York Times columnist who was a biographer of Harry Blackmun, an old friend of mine, I ran into her when the book was still in galleys, and I asked her, how are you going to deal with the fact that Justice Blackmun's ashes are at the Aspen Institute. And she looked at me like I was completely crazy and said, what do you mean? I was at his funeral. He's buried at Arlington Cemetery. And I said, well, not all of him is buried at Arlington Cemetery. And this was a very, very important place to Harry Blackmun. Starting in 1979, he spent many summers here, many weeks, leading a seminar called Justice and Society. And for those of you interested, and I think particularly in a period when arguably, certainly perhaps, his most important well-known case was overruled, it might not be a bad time just to stroll by and pay your respects. But if you're interested, if you're walking on the main path between Pepke Auditorium and Aspen Meadows, and just after you pass that large mound on your right, and you look off to your right, only about 30 yards, just in the grass before a little aspen grove, there is a little stone and a plaque on it with his name and his birth date and his date of death, and the following words: he loved this meadow and wished to be here. So I think that is just an apt, very local, significant comment. The other comment, which is, I think, little remembered and is relevant to some of the things we'll be talking about today, is relates to the fact that I was a Supreme Court law clerk just 7 years after Roe against Wade was decided. And 8 of the 9 justices were the same justices who were on Roe against Wade. And for many people, I think there's a presumption that that was a perhaps a very liberal court or whatever, but the reality is not only was Justice Blackmun, of course, a Republican, but 5 of the 7 in the majority were appointed by Republican presidents, and 4 were Republicans themselves, including the justice I worked for, who was even an elected Republican office holder in his native Ohio. And one of the justices in the majority, again, Roe v. Wade, was also Chief Justice Warren Burger, who of course was was widely regarded as very conservative for his time. The dissenters included a Democrat. So just very interesting. And of course, another thing that's changed since that time, and many other things have changed, is there were no women on that court or on the court that I was on. So let us begin with our wonderful panelists. Really, there have been a couple of earthquakes that have been felt not only here in Aspen, but all over the country in the last few months. First, when the opinion in Dobbs was leaked, and that's mentioned in the advertising for this conversation. And then, of course, when the decision actually came out. And remarkably, for those who haven't compared it word for word, very little was actually changed. We're not going to talk today about the textual analysis, and obviously that was a decision that really shook the country, and many, many of our compatriots reacted with enormous pleasure, saying, hallelujah, it's about time, and many others, of course, were shocked by what they thought the implications would be. We could spend an entire hour just on this, but we won't. But let me just ask and both of our panelists to comment on what you see as the implications of this. As we see, we're increasingly, it looks like we have 2 countries, red states and blue states, abortion still legal in some and criminalized even in others. What does this mean? And Ruth, I'll start with you.
Okay, well, one could spend an entire hour on this, so I'll try to narrow my focus. One of the things that the court and the majority and its defenders said was, oh, thank goodness, this will now get the courts out of the business of deciding abortion cases, and we can return that to the citizens of the states, or perhaps the citizens of the country where it belongs. The notion that the courts are getting out of the abortion case deciding business anytime soon is, I think the legal term is balderdash. Is that about right, Neal? Is crazy. First of all, there is the immediate chaos as state after state and their state courts try to figure out what the status of their antiquated or trigger laws or new laws are in the aftermath of the decision. Second of all, we're gonna have a whole new set in, if not 50 states, many states, of litigation over what is the meaning of state constitutions, many of which have similar phrasing to the federal constitution and are going to need to grapple with this. And then even after those two things settle out, we are going to see a constitutional law professor's dream of litigation over some of the really important practical questions that are going to come up. Can this state, red state, prohibit its citizens from traveling to a blue state to obtain an abortion? Probably not, but I guarantee you it's going to be litigated. Can this red state punish its citizens after they return for having an abortion? Can it try to punish doctors who practice telemedicine or treat women in other states and then send them back to the red state? Can the FDA insist that states have to make medication abortions available? Or on the other side of things, which is probably more likely, can red states go after women who are obtaining medication abortions, which are now, as many people here know, more than half of abortions in this country? Can they go through the mail? Can they somehow surveil women to do this? This is going to be a practical nightmare for women across the country, from my point of view, but it is also going to be a legal nightmare for the courts, and that is kind of just the beginning of the implications of this decision.
Neal?
Before answering, I first want to just say I love this place, like Justice Blackmun. I climbed Ajax Mountain this morning with a film crew behind me as we were recording a podcast, which was insane. Don't do that. But I was thinking about just how much I love the Aspen Institute in particular for bringing people together. I'm so grateful to my friends, the Hursts and the Louders, for supporting this event today. And you know, we're talking about the Supreme Court. I dressed appropriately in all black. So I am, you know, before getting to the abortion question itself and the implications, just to frame the lens a little bit more broadly, I am very worried about this Supreme Court. And I've dedicated my entire professional life to the Supreme Court. It's my lifeblood. It's the thing I care most about. It's the thing that I've always thought of as the crown jewel in our democracy. But this is right now the most conservative Supreme Court in our lifetimes, and indeed one of the three most conservative Supreme Courts in the history of the United States. The other two were 1857 and 1935. That didn't work out too well, either of them. And you know, I worry so much because the reason the Supreme Court works is because, as the great legal scholar Alexander Bickel said back in 1963 in writing the most important book in constitutional law of the last century, he said it works because of the passive virtues. It works because the Supreme Court's not like the president, not like Congress. They don't have to take every issue. Indeed, they have discretion and turn down so many cases. They get about 10,000 requests to hear a case a year. They take about 60, and many of them are not ones that are about abortion or guns or whatever. They're important technical cases, but they're technical. And the court husbands its legitimacy, it conserves its legitimacy by making sure they don't do too much at any one time. That's the Alexander Bickel thesis. What you have today is really the opposite of that, the anti-Bickelian Alito court, a court that is grabbing every issue it can. Even this abortion case from Mississippi, it involved a 15-week ban on abortion. Now, Roe versus Wade was at 24, so there was some inconsistency. But what the Alito court did was say, you know what? It's not just that we're going to uphold the 15-week ban that Mississippi has. We'll uphold a ban at 0 weeks if a state has that. They went and reached out to decide something that wasn't presented in the case. And that's something true in case after case this
and
term.
And which is why the Chief Justice did not join that opinion.
Exactly. The Chief Justice, who's not, you know, some flaming liberal, said, I'm not joining this part of the Mississippi opinion for exactly that reason. It's also true in guns. It's true in the Environmental Protection Act, the climate case we'll talk about. It's true in so many different areas. And that, to me, is the big worry. Abortion is obviously central, and it raises so many issues that Ruth is talking about. But there's also a bigger conversation about how this court has really lost its conservative moorings, and by conservative I mean in the old sense of the word, of not doing too much at any one time, being Burkean, looking to precedent, to say there's a wisdom of past generations. We're not just going to go and reinvent the wheel every time we get a new justice and we have more power. And you know, so the implications for me of Roe being overruled are, if Roe can be overruled, literally any precedent can be overruled. Because Roe is actually a super precedent. It's the precedent that actually was the hardest for the Supreme Court to overturn. Remember, it was a 7-2 decision in 1973 at a point when 7 justices on the court were Republican. It was then reaffirmed in 1992 when some people thought, well, maybe it was vulnerable. It was a trio of Republican justices who came together, O'Connor, Souter, and Kennedy, and said, no, regardless of what you think about whether Roe was right or wrong initially, it is woven into the fabric of the land. It's one of the few decisions that Americans know by name. If we, the Supreme Court, overrule it, our legitimacy will be imperiled. It'll look like we just got some new justices on the court and we're not doing law anymore. That's what they overruled. As I said in Ruth's paper, a few hours after the decision, the leak was out there, I wrote an op-ed saying, you know, same-sex marriage is on the line, you know, the right to contraception is on the line, marriage equality is on the line. I mean, anything. If you can overrule Roe, you can overrule anything. So that's what I think the implications are.
Let's just stay on that. And by the way, for those of you interested in this question about, you know, was this something a conservative court would do? Ruth's, I think, most recent column talks about just that, because they did not need to go as far as they did to actually affirm the Mississippi law. But let's talk about what you were just talking about, Neal, which is the implications of this. And in the opinion, there are essentially dueling concurrences. On the one hand, Justice Kavanaugh basically says, oh, don't worry, this is not going to affect women traveling from Nebraska to Colorado. He didn't use those examples, of state to state. This is about abortion, it's not about anything else. But Clarence Thomas's concurrence actually explicitly almost invites and welcomes a review of these cases dealing with what's called a substantive due process, as Neal mentioned, things like contraception, same-sex marriage, same-sex intimacy, and the like. How do the two of you see those implications at the next level?
So I think that I would distinguish between what the court, if it's going to be intellectually consistent, would do, and I think for the reasons that Neal said, that is a big if. This is a court that is consistently reaching conservative results, but it is reaching these results through distinctly unconservative means. One of them, as Neal mentioned, is to ignore or eviscerate the doctrine of stare decisis, but it has other tricks up its sleeve. It looks to history, but it only cherry picks the history that it's most comfortable with. It looks to text, except when the text is convenient. It respects precedents, except when the precedents are inconvenient. The only way, I think, to understand this court and its intellectual consistency is to say there isn't intellectual consistency unless you know the outcome, for the most part, that they are driving to. So if you are a law professor, some people here are, and we're looking at the case and you were saying, are other doctrines of substantive due process, the right to contraception, the right to private sexual intimacy and homosexual conduct that the court laid out in Lawrence v. Texas, the right to same-sex marriage, are those in jeopardy as an intellectual matter? Absolutely they are, for two reasons. The first is what Neal said about the disrespect for stare decisis. If they could overrule Roe, they could overrule anything. The second is that the building blocks of Roe, which come from the privacy right and the liberty right in the 14th Amendment, came from Griswold v. Connecticut, the contraception case. They form the basis of the private sexual conduct cases that resulted in the same-sex marriage case. The conservative justices can say all they want that this one is different because it involves potential human life, but there is no rational basis, to use a legal term, for them to make that distinction and to say, well, we accept rights that are grounded in the history and text and essential to the concept of ordered liberty, but we've somehow divined a contraception right, but we can't divine an abortion right. It doesn't make any sense. At the same time, and I want to be a little glimmer of hope here, I'm not wearing all black like Neal. I think as a practical matter, and you talked about the implications, as a practical matter, I don't think we're going to see many states, though there were some really crazy things coming out of Texas, going after contraception. I don't think we're going to see many states going after private homosexual conduct. I don't think we're even, because it is so of much a fabric of our society, people are so reliant on the marriages that they've entered into with the imprimatur of the state and the blessing of the Supreme Court and the support of the public. It's now up to 70%. I don't think as a practical matter those rights are in the kind of jeopardy that some people believe they are, and that I have to say the dissent, which scared the joint dissent, which I thought was a wonderful document, really argued very forcefully that they're coming for you.
So, and we're going to come back to many of these things, including what you've alluded to and Neal mentioned earlier, which is the legitimacy of the court and what we can do about that. One other thing that's happened amidst these earthquakes is the appointment of a new justice, Ketanji Brown Jackson, replacing Stephen Breyer. I wonder if either of you would comment on what it's going to be like for this newest justice and whether we can expect anything different in the near term.
Yeah, I'm happy to start on that, but before doing so, I did want to just respond to a couple of things from my friend Ruth, and it's such a privilege to be here with you. You are just an extraordinary...
Ditto.
I mean, she writes the best legal columns every time, so it's a real... And I hope that... I'd like to have your hope about state legislatures not doing the wrong thing. I do think our constitutional rights, like contraception, shouldn't be left up to the whims of a state legislature. I think that is part of our constitutional guarantee as an American citizen to have them. But you know, hopefully they will do the right thing. But I look at Louisiana right now, which is contemplating banning IUDs. And I look at what happened in Texas just today. They threatened a law firm, Sidley and Austin, because Sidley was willing to pay the out-of-state expenses for their employees to travel across state lines to get an abortion, and they said that would violate their criminal laws and that they would be prosecuted. This is a group of Texas legislators who were writing that letter to this law firm. You know, so there's a lot of stuff to me that's worrisome. Marriage equality, I had the privilege of working on that case for 4 years, but as it wound its way up to the Supreme Court, it was one of the most moving moments of my life. But it was marred by the fact that it was a 5-4 decision, and that was when the court looked really different. There were four justices who said there is no right to marriage equality, and now you have three new justices on the court since then, but not including Justice Jackson. So, I do worry about these things. With respect to Justice Jackson, I would put a white shirt on if I could. I have a lot of optimism about her. She is remarkably brilliant. She's got the personal skills that it takes to kind of do a job right now that's incredibly, incredibly hard. She's walking into an environment where she is likely to be a dissenter on many of the issues for many of the next decades. But she is as smart and capable as they come. And if anyone can pull some, you know, can create lemonade out of lemons, it's Justice Jackson.
Well, I don't think there's going to be a lot of lemonade creation on this court. I do think that no justice that I'm aware of has joined the court in the position that Justice Jackson has, which is it's kind of marching to doom. You know, in the cases that I mean, imagine you find yourself in this amazing circumstance of becoming a Supreme Court justice, and yet you know, because you're smart enough to know, that in the cases that matter most to you, you are consigned to be writing dissents with your two liberal colleagues for as long as the eye can see, unless something dramatically changes. Because I seem to be picking the sort of side of let's find a little bit of lemonade in this dreary moment, I would say that I started writing about the Supreme Court when there were no women on the court, and I wrote about it for many years when there was one woman on the court, and then two. Now we have four. Justice Ginsburg would tell us that when we'll be satisfied when there are nine. That's not happening anytime soon. But I really do think for my daughters, one of whom is in law school, for the people in this audience, having four women on the Supreme Court and across the ideological spectrum is a good testament to where women, and I'm now tempted to say, thanks in part to the ability to decide their own reproductive destinies, but where women have come in society over the years that I've been alive. In fact, over the years since I graduated from college.
I want to say just one thing about that, because I think Ruth is absolutely right. I bring a group of kindergartners to the court every year to watch the Supreme Court argue for an hour, which is itself quite a challenge to keep them quiet. But when I started doing this, there were two women justices. And I haven't gone with four because of the COVID restrictions, but I have gone almost every year with three since Justice Kagan joined the court. And it is different when those kindergarten girls go and look out at that bench and see three. And now four.
Now they're going to see a black woman.
And now they're going to, yes, exactly. And so I do think that's a remarkable, remarkable thing. It hasn't penetrated, for example, the Supreme Court bar. Right? If you go look over the last 5 years, who's arguing at the court? 83% of oral arguments are done by men. 83%. There's no profession I know that's still quite like that. It is a disgrace. And so, you know, my hat's off to both Republican and Democratic presidents for doing the right thing here.
Let's move to another topic that has a great deal of cultural resonance in this country, and also the whole world today is thinking about, which is guns and the tragedy that happened in Japan today. And you contrast that with tragedies that happen in this country on a daily basis. Again, thinking about how things have changed, I can't help but think, and I mentioned Chief Justice Berger earlier, it wasn't that long ago where the Republican Chief Justice said of the Second Amendment, essentially, that it was folly for anyone to think that it provides an individual right to bear arms. And actually, I think he used the word, there's never been a fraud. And he repeated the word fraud twice, perpetrated on the American public by an interest group like the one suggesting that there is an individual right to bear arms. Well, we have an individual right to bear arms now. And there was another gun case this year. Neal, I mean, was that a surprise decision to you?
It was a bit of a surprise, because I am a very optimistic person about the court. And I know that several of the justices, particularly Justice Kavanaugh, when they were on the lower courts, wrote really extreme Second Amendment opinions. But I had hoped that when they looked at the history carefully, they would realize that they've really gone off the rails. I have the privilege of arguing the Hawaii case, which was about an 1852 ban on concealed firearms. And I argued it before a big panel of a very conservative panel of the Ninth Circuit. And we got in a decision written by Judge Bybee, one of the most conservative judges in the country. And his decision, it's about 200 pages long, goes through all the history and says the Second Amendment doesn't confer this kind of unlimited individual right that the NRA has like basically spun up out of thin air. And it was so powerful, I thought the Supreme Court had that when they were deciding the New York case. I thought that would change the minds of people like Justice Kavanaugh who didn't have all that history available to them. I mean, you go all the way back to, you know, 1305 England and the statute in Northampton, and there have been restriction after restriction on the right, on the ability to bear arms. And so That's what I thought. I also kind of thought, you know, my hope always springs eternal for logical consistency at the United States Supreme Court. And I thought, if this was the court that was going to say, well, abortion, while really important to certain people, that should be left to the states and political branches to decide, a little hard for me to see how they can't say that about guns. But here on the guns case, this New York decision said, you have a right in the 50 states to go and carry your firearm in a concealed way. And even if a state 100% disagrees with that, every person wants to pass a law that says you're not allowed to do that. You need to have restrictions on that. You have to have licensing or whatever. Even if 100% of people in the state wanted to have that, this Supreme Court says, right to bear arms is so fundamental, the people can't decide that. I don't understand how you say one thing on one day and one the next day.
Okay, let me ask something else, though. thinking about guns case, abortion case, and we do want to get to a few others before we open it up as well, couldn't one just argue that one party that cares deeply about some issues that many Americans care deeply about over the last 5 decades has simply been far more effective in our democratic system with state elections, appointment of judges, federal appointments, focusing on a few things that are terribly important, and moving the law in a way, in our democratic system with our minoritarian features in our Constitution, allow them to do. It's just a matter of greater political success, better organizing, and more passion.
That is 100% the story of the last 30 or 40 years, is that the conservative legal movement, especially after the defeat of Robert Bork as a Supreme Court nominee in 1987, declared that that was a never again moment for them. And they organized politically, they organized the financial wherewithal to get this done. They created and nurtured the Federalist Society, which identified and groomed and credentialized conservative lawyers who then became conservative judges, who then became conservative justices. And we see the fruits of this. And while the conservative legal movement and the Republican Party and its apparatus did this, it saw its flowering in the Trump administration, but it was the culmination of years of this effort. The Democratic Party and its voters did not pay the same kind of attention to the ideological makeup of the courts. Its voters were not determined single issue voters who cared about abortion rights and turned out for that reason, who cared about guns and turned out for that reason, who understood that to a major extent that both of these rights were in contradictory ways, as Neal points out, were in the hands of the Supreme Court and the lower federal courts, and so they needed to make that a priority. It will be really interesting to see the degree to which this activist radical Supreme Court energizes, whether they do or not, finally energize Democratic voters to understand the importance of the courts. But if this doesn't do it, nothing will.
Let me ask about another case that came out in the last week of the term, and that's involving the entire Environmental Protection Agency and the so-called administrative state. And Neal, you're very familiar with these issues. Explain to us why the court said the Environmental Protection Agency does not have the power to protect the environment with respect to climate.
Can I answer three words for you? Because it could.
Yeah, so this case involves the Clean Power Plan, which President Obama put into effect, and it imposed a whole series of restrictions on emissions in order to reduce the greenhouse gases, the climate change. It's been a long, complicated procedural history, but basically it goes to the Supreme Court, and the question is, does the EPA have the ability to regulate greenhouse gas emissions? And the answer given by the Supreme Court, as Ruth says, because they can, is no. The Environmental Protection Agency doesn't have the ability, because this is a major question, and Congress has to give agencies, when they vest them with major questions, has to expressly do so and say, agency, we are telling you, you have the power to do X. Now, I guess calling this the Environmental Protection Agency wasn't specific enough for people to understand that that allows them to protect the environment. But that is unfortunately what a majority of the Supreme Court said. Justice Kagan, who I continue to think will be one of, if not President Obama's greatest legacies to the nation, she's just an incredible jurist. She has this line in there saying, well, I guess I was wrong when I said earlier, we are all textualists now. Melissa Murray, the NYU law professor, put it last week, she said, it's textualist-ish. It's not textual, because you know, obviously Congress has given the Environmental Protection Agency power to deal with major threats to the environment. That was the whole point of the Organic Act. And it's also really ironic, this is like, you know, coming a couple days after they say the Constitution has no implied right to an abortion in it. We're against implied rights. But when it comes to the EPA, they say, oh, you know, there's this major questions doctrine in our Constitution and our structure of government. That's nowhere in there either. That's not in the text of the Constitution. It's entirely made up. And so, again, it goes back to Ruth's point about logical consistency.
It is entirely made up. There is no such text. Congress writes broad statutes, and it's not just, by the way, if you're nervous about the EPA case, you should be really nervous, because it doesn't just constrain the EPA. It constrains the entire regulatory apparatus of the federal government. I see my husband nodding, because he was the head of a regulatory agency. And What it says is, the Chief Justice said it's in extraordinary circumstances, but I think extraordinary circumstances means when it really annoys us, and when we think it doesn't make sense, and when we think Congress should have acted. You may have noticed that Congress has not been very good at getting its job done. So it's very hard for Congress, when it sees even a decision of the Supreme Court that a majority disagrees with on a piece of legislation, to go back and fix that the way it used to. And Congress writes statutes because it understands it's creating expert regulatory agencies, it's investing them with power because it can't imagine or foresee the issues that are coming. When it didn't foresee climate change, but it knew it wanted to protect the environment, as Neal says. But this happens across the spectrum of regulatory actions, and it really underscores the radicalness, and this is not a word that I use lightly, the radicalness of this court, because the major questions doctrine is just made up because these conservative justices do not like government regulation.
Let's talk about another cultural hot spot and hot button and cases at the end of this term, and that's religion. And let's stay with you, Ruth. There were two First Amendment religion cases, one involving a prayer on a 50-yard line in a public school, and one involving a religious school in Maine. What are the implications of those cases? And are there implications? Are we going to have prayer in schools again?
Well, we're going to actually have prayer in publicly funded schools. We know that because the court has said not just that states are free if they wish to provide financial help to private religious schools that teach religious doctrine and imbue their students with religious doctrine, they are required under this case that we have seen to do that. And I think this, I want to say one thing about the way this court operates. I think it was Hemingway who said that there are two ways to go bankrupt. You do it very gradually and then all at once. This court has two ways to change the law. It changes the law in the way that I think of as the Chief Justice Roberts and Justice Kavanaugh way, which is very gradually, and that's what the Chief Justice did in the religion cases, and then it changes it all at once, which is what the rest of this, Justice Sotomayor called this newly constituted and restless court did, because it had a change in rules. So this has been an enterprise of the Chief Justice for many years. And what these two cases together mean is that these two magnificent clauses of the Constitution that are at some tension with each other, the Establishment Clause, there can't be a state establishment, religion, the Free Exercise Clause, you have to have free exercise of religion. The free exercise, the court has talked about this area of the law as there being play in the joints. And we go back and forth and accommodate among these things. The play in the joints is now rigged for one side. The free exercise claim is going to always win in this court. And the court is teed up for next year to take up a really important case. It's kind of free exercise case that's dressed in First Amendment clothing, but it raises a question that the court kind of punted a few years ago in a case called Masterpiece Cake Shop. And it's about when you have, and I think it's a Colorado case, right? So yeah. When you have somebody engaged in enterprise and commercial enterprise, and there's a law that says you have to serve everybody equally, does the baker's religious scruples permit the baker to refuse to create a cake, you know, a custom cake celebrating a same-sex wedding? Now we're going to start the decision-making about the baker's First Amendment rights. In this case, it's a website designer. Then it's going to be the baker's religious freedom rights. And we know where this is going because we know what this court thinks.
Ruth just talked about a case for next term. You know, the other thing that happens at the end of every Supreme Court term that especially people closely following the court look at with extraordinary interest are the cases they accept for next year. And among the cases that they're going to take next year, one that was announced a little earlier, and actually I think, Neal, you're an advocate in both of these cases, so particularly appropriate to comment on them, but there's going to be a very important affirmative action case next year, and then we just learned in the last days of this Supreme Court term about a case that involves something called the independent state legislation issue as it relates to interpreting or in guiding state rules with respect to federal elections. Can you just give us a quick, because we're going to turn things to the audience in a second, a quick sense of what each of those cases involve and where they may go?
Yeah, so you might remember at the start of my remarks, I talked about how this is an anti-Bakelian court, a court that's reaching out to grab issues. And these two cases are good illustrations of a court that's really trying to do a lot. It's like, as Lynn Miranda says, why do you write like you're running out of time? I mean, these guys are writing like they're running out of time and trying to grab as much as they can. So the affirmative action case, there's two of them. They're from Harvard and from University of North Carolina. And they ask the question, are racial preferences in college admissions constitutional at all? And I'm not going to say anything about the merits just because I'm involved in both these cases, but that's the question there. Since 1978, affirmative action in the university's setting has stood on very strong constitutional foundations. It's been affirmed by Republican-appointed justices after Republican-appointed justices and Democratic ones alike. But it does look like now there's at least some thought that this newly constituted Alito court will try and overrule all of these past affirmative action decisions. I think there's five of them or so over the last 25 years. The other case coming out of North Carolina, but it involves everything, is whether in federal elections, state courts have any role to play. So you might think about the bright spot of the last few years is that when Donald Trump filed all those bogus lawsuits with that great legal team behind him, that it was rejected time and again, 62 different times. Many of those rejections were in state courts. And state courts were able to say, you know, Trump, this is a bogus claim, and so on. Voter fraud allegations, not true. Polling places, to the extent polling places were being closed unfairly, you could go to state court and get those things reversed and, you know, in time for the election to happen. But what this kind of, I think it's Federalist Society initially developed a theory that said, you know what? State courts have no business in federal elections at all. They're not allowed to play any part. Only the state legislatures can play a part. And lo and behold, who controls most of the state legislatures, as Ruth said a moment ago, Republicans. So this is a theory that says, let's empower state legislators. State Supreme Courts even have no business in the election process. It's a totally radical and ahistorical view of the Constitution, but nonetheless, that's what the court is going to be hearing. I said I wouldn't talk about the merits, but I guess I did a little bit.
Well, I promised I would share this opportunity with all of you here, and we're going to go a little bit beyond the original starting time. And I can't necessarily see very well, but we've got runners who, if you could please find people and make sure, I see some hands over there too, that we respect people on either wings here. Okay, right here, please.
Focus on the gun case for a minute, New York. Scalia wrote Heller, and in Scalia's opinion, he indicated that it's appropriate for local or national or state jurisdictions to impose appropriate limitations on the right to bear arms. This court appears to have completely gutted Scalia's opinion, which is really frightening. And I'm just sort of curious as to where you think this is going to go.
Nowhere good. Thank you so much for asking that question. The Heller decision was wrong, but it didn't need to be a disaster. And actually, it really, in the 12 years since it was decided, it hasn't been a disaster, and it hasn't been a disaster for the reason that you mentioned. I suspect it wasn't that Justice Scalia was itching to put in those exceptions, but at the behest, we now understand, of Justice Kennedy, he put in a bunch of exceptions saying nothing in this newly understood right should be understood to interfere with the ability of states to impose traditional restrictions on felons' ability to get guns, on the protection of sensitive places, and other things. And the lower federal courts have pretty much stuck with that, implemented that, and come up with reasonable, as you were saying in your Ninth Circuit case, Neal, reasonable conclusions. But that 5-4 court that decided Heller is, Justice Kennedy, you may notice, is gone. He's replaced by Justice Kavanaugh. Justice Kavanaugh doesn't see it that way. He thinks that we should only look to history. And when we only look to history, and we can look to cherry-picked history, as we've seen, what this is going to mean, I believe, is in case after case after case, at least as these cases bubble their way up through courts, that especially appeals courts that still have significant numbers of Republican and Trump-appointed judges, you are going to see gun legislation after gun legislation struck down. And I'm just going to say one more sentence about this, which is in the midst of this national crisis and disaster that we're having with guns, the unwillingness of this majority to recognize the gun problem in America, the unwillingness of this majority to recognize the climate change challenge that America is facing. They are just resolutely focused on what they insist is the text, except it's only the text that they want to see, except when they want to invent it. They are unwilling to grapple, as the framers intended, with the documents as a way to deal with the real problems of America as they have evolved and face us now. And instead, they want to look to history as if it's some sort of objective standard. And thank you for giving me the chance to rant about that case, because I really wanted to.
And just two more sentences, because I don't want people to misunderstand. When Justice Scalia wrote that decision in 2008, saying there's an individual right to bear arms, that itself was remarkably radical. We've had guns since the founding, obviously. The Supreme Court for 200 years never thought that. It took till the year 2008 for there magically to be discovered now this right to bear, individual right to bear arms that Justice Scalia found.
Okay, right here. And again, I'm relying on the mic runners because I can't see very well to make sure we have variety and just signal to me who's ready, but please.
Two quickies, hopefully.
Actually, one quickie because we have lots of other people.
Okay. What is your point of view on having one justice for each federal circuit?
In other words,
13 justices.
Can you speak out of the mic? Court expansion.
What is your opinion on having one justice for each federal circuit?
Which would expand the
which
court.
Which would expand the court to 13.
I covered the court when it was deciding 150 cases a term. They don't need to expand to deal with their workload. I think it would be an even greater disaster for the court, despite all of my criticisms of it, to expand the court. That would just usher in a tit-for-tat expansion and guarantee that we've destroyed the village in order to save it.
Okay. Next question. Is there someone back there, please?
So this is a question for Neal. At some point, you supported the appointments of Gorsuch, Kavanaugh, and Comey Barrett. There's also been senators who supported their confirmations but have since said they felt misled when it comes to their stances on Roe and expressed shock at the draft leak. Were you shocked by the leak, and do you still support their appointments knowing where they ultimately stand on federal abortion protections?
Well, I was very shocked by the leak. You know, I clerked for Justice Breyer, and the idea that, you know, someone in the building would leak or something like that is just unfathomable. And I really do worry about the impact on the court. I think the only justice that I publicly supported was Justice Gorsuch. And again, as I said at the time, he was replacing Justice Scalia. And, you know, Justice Scalia for Justice Gorsuch, you can make an argument it moved the court a little bit to the left. It certainly did on Native American rights, on LGBT rights, on criminal justice, on some criminal justice matters. But, you know, that's a reasonable thing different folks can argue. What I said back then was, I was Elena Kagan's deputy solicitor general. I was very upset with Republicans who said she wasn't qualified. I thought that was just absurd. And I wanted that yardstick applied for every confirmation from then on. And, you know, if the yardstick's going to be thrown out and it's going to be mere politics, you know, as we seem to be moving towards, that's really unfortunate. Because to me, the great thing about going into the Supreme Court for so many years is I walk in and there are votes in play. They're listening to me. Justice Kennedy, there was an article called The Agonizer. He used to agonize about his decisions, listening to every word and trying to figure out. There weren't like sure votes for one thing or sure votes for another thing. And I'm very worried that the trend of this court is to move off of that.
I think we have a microphone back here.
It seems like we've become quite fundamentalists, and I was wondering if you think that we are. Also, are we fighting a hot nuclear civil war? And what do you think the fix is other than the election? Is there a fix to with Thomas and getting him in term limits? What do you think alternative quick fixes are for this situation other than the vote?
I don't think there is a quick institutional fix, though I do think term limits are a really good idea, and there may be ways to do that short of a constitutional amendment, but you get the court that you lobby for and that you vote for. And one of the critical, I write about this in my book, if you don't mind my saying so, one of the critical things that helped Donald Trump achieve the presidency was that he took the extraordinary step of putting out a public list of, actually, none of the justices he eventually nominated were on his initial public list, but it was, and for a good reason. That list was designed to tell conservative and, in particular, evangelical voters that he was with them, they could trust him. And so they did. And that's why we are where we are now.
And I would say, you know, for my entire lifetime, for 50 years, the Supreme Court has always had a Republican-nominated majority on it. What's different is this Supreme Court has people who are much more sure votes. They're much more extreme than past Republican nominees. And the solution, if you're upset about that, is to, we got to win presidential elections. And that's
and
what-
And the Senate.
And the Senate, and that's what Donald Trump so effectively did back then to get these appointees on the court. I was heartened on July 4th here at the parade, seeing hundreds of men and women marching for abortion rights and saying things about that. And I think if this is gonna change, if we're gonna get out of this hole, President Biden's opponent in 2024 is not Donald Trump, it's not Rick DeSantis, it is the United States Supreme Court. That's the election.
Although also Neal, as you talk about that, but it's also Republican-appointed justices after elections in which the Democrats actually won more of the popular vote. Front row, and then back here.
Would you agree with the following argument, that the current Supreme Court is evidence that Democrats and liberals have made a catastrophic decision in seeking justice with judges, with regulators, and with presidents, everywhere, that is, except for Congress? The courts have said repeatedly, if you want to change the law, elect state legislatures and elect Congresses that will change the law. Isn't that a valid argument?
Sure. One of the things that Republicans have done and one of the tragedies that I think we witnessed during the Obama years, which you know, were not tragic from my point of view overall, was the evaporation of, I think it was 900 Democratic-held seats in state legislatures. One of the things that we've learned over the last several years is the importance of all of these elected officials, the importance of local school boards, the importance of secretaries of state. Who among us understood before 2020 what it was that secretaries of state did? The importance of state governors now. If we don't build up, if the Democratic Party does not build up a cadre of people who are in elected office, it cannot propel them into further elected office, and you are going to get the results that we're witnessing now.
Sewell, I definitely agree with you that the Democrats, liberals have got a little addicted to judicial review as a way to accomplish their ends. They went to court to get stuff done. They couldn't get through the legislative process. That worked for a time. It's obviously not working now. Gerald Rosenberg wrote a whole book about this called The Hollow Hope, about just the danger of putting your faith in the court. On the other side, though, I'd say, even now, if Democrats win all the state legislatures, win the U.S. Senate, win the House of Representatives, indeed, even win the presidency, what we are talking about now, what Ruth and I have been trying to explain for the last hour, is we have a Supreme Court that's using the Constitution to strike those democratically done acts out and say they're unconstitutional. So even if 100% of people want the Voting Rights Act, or even if 100% of people want gun restrictions, this Supreme Court is saying, we get to zero that out and make it ineffective. So politics alone can't actually be the solution. We also have to do something about the jurisprudence of this Supreme Court.
We just have a few minutes left. I think there's a question over here, and was there one right here? Okay, why don't you go first, and then we're gonna go over there. But why don't you each ask your questions, and then they can respond to both of them, please.
Okay, on one hand, this court is all about religious liberty. On the other hand, they are against abortion. I've heard about a case in Florida in which a rabbi who is also an attorney is bringing up the fact that in the Torah, life starts at birth. What happens if that becomes a case? I don't know where it stands or if it even is.
Okay, and let's hear this question too, and
so
then comment
first,
on both.
Thank you all for being here. My question is really, I'd like you both, Ruth and Neal, to comment on how we got here, changing the rule from requiring 60 votes from 50, 60 of course would have required some bipartisan support. And do you think the party in power, recognizing how bad it is now with our Supreme Court, would ever change the rule back to 50?
Okay, so a different kind of religion question and sort of a filibuster question.
Some of you in this room may be Jewish, like me, and you know, Jews can never agree about anything, and they definitely can't agree among different parts of the Jewish community about what the rules are on abortion rights. I think that's going to be, I think it raises a really interesting question, but I think that's going to be a really hard case to win, and it's not going to be the solution to say that it interferes with my religious liberties to not let me have an abortion when I'm not kind of following a lot of other rules about that are part of my religious teaching. So I'm not sure that one is going to get over the hump. I wrote so many times about what a disaster it was going to be for Democrats to reduce the number of votes needed to a simple majority for the appeals courts. Everybody who knew that at the time understood that it was going to get to the Supreme Court as soon as it needed to get to the Supreme Court. It was actually a mistake to filibuster Gorsuch, because if they hadn't done it then, the Republicans would have been in the position of not only having to amass the votes for Justice Kavanaugh in the midst of the allegations against him, but also to undo the filibuster rules. The argument on the other side is they would have done it anyway. They would have done it anyway. At least we got some actually quite wonderful judges on the D.C. Circuit as a result of our undoing the the filibuster rules. I think of this as the same way, by the way, for the arguments against getting rid of the filibuster now. You get rid of the filibuster now so you could pass a law that protects abortion rights nationwide. Tell me what happens next, because I've seen this play before. What happens next is the Republicans take control of the Senate, they have a Republican president, and they pass a law that is probably going to be on firmer constitutional footing. Neal can check me on this. To eliminate abortion rights nationwide. That's a really big disaster. But the filibuster is for judicial nominees is water under the bridge. We are where we are, but it's really too bad, because if we had to get to 60 votes, justices who could command 60 votes, we would have a different court than the court that we have now. We would not have Justice Gorsuch, we would not have Justice Kavanaugh, we would not have Justice Barrett.
And I just want to say one thing that Ruth said really quickly, because, you know, in the writing after the abortion decision and the Supreme Court's abortion decision, and Dobbs said, oh, we're just leaving this up to the states. We're leaving it up to the states. And if you live in New York, you're fine. If you're in Texas, it's a different story. But that's, you know, it's a state federalism thing. But Ruth is absolutely right. The Republican platform is to pass a nationwide ban on abortions for all 50 states, take it away from the states, and if they have 50 votes in the Senate and a majority of the House, you know, that legislation is going to pass. And so, you know, don't think of this as just simply it's left up to the states, because there's now this big national battle that's going to be fought as well.
So let me remind you, if you have friends whom you think would like to listen to this conversation, it's all on YouTube, or will be very shortly. Our time is up. Please thank these wonderful guests.